Grace and peace to you, United Church, and welcome to worship. It's great to share with you this morning. We're celebrating Thanksgiving at Van Riebeek Street United Church this Sunday, and both our campuses, the Kamandi and the Van Riebeek Street campuses, will be joining together to sing and worship, to share testimonies, to bring our Thanksgiving offerings, and afterwards we'll be treating our over 65s to a lunch. Now, we're in Philippians chapter 4, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. And it's also the first Sunday of Advent, and the promises of God we focus on the first Sunday of Advent. We look forward to the birth of Christ, but we talk about the precursors, and one of them is the prophets, and those who promised what God would do in the future through Jesus. So join us as we take a little meander through Philippians, but also please come down to worship and join us at worship as we are able to worship together, and be lovely to see you again in the sanctuary as we worship together. Now, don't forget our Christmas services also, which are the midnight service at 11:30, and then also a Christmas morning service at 8 o'clock. Come and join us and celebrate with us the incarnation of Christ. Why don't you pray with me as we come to the scriptures? Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for teaching us in it. We thank you that we can rely on the words of Jesus and the word of God we find in the scriptures, that when we read the scriptures, we reliably hear the word of God and can know you as we read it. And so, Father, open our hearts and teach us, inform us, draw us closer to you in our commitment and in our walk with Jesus. We pray it in his name. Amen.
The reading this morning is taken from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 to 9. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Amen.
May the words of our mouths, the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Now, I don't know if you remember a song from the 80s. It was Bobby McFerrin, and the song went something like this. Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. But don't worry, be happy. And it repeated that refrain throughout the song. Don't worry, be happy. And it was a great little song. In fact, you just enjoyed it and almost you felt less stressed as you read it. And now Paul says to the Philippian church, rejoice, be happy, rejoice in the Lord always. And it's a famous text. It's one we hear all the time, and it's often read just as an encouragement. And I often use it in prayers as I'm praying for people when we bring our prayers of request and requests to the Lord. But this is more than the kind of bumper sticker or pop song that Paul is bringing. Just before it, he's spoken about some conflict in the church and these Euodia and Syntyche who are having a dispute of some sort. And it's interesting, of course, we don't know exactly what the history is, but it's interesting that the name Clement comes up in the middle of it. And one of our Bible study members asked, isn't it possible that the two of them were both in love with Clement? And so there's some dispute had arisen. There was unrequited love somewhere. Well, whatever the case was, there was clearly some relational conflict going on. And Paul the Apostle was troubled by this. And I think once you've been in ministry for any length of time, one of the things that trouble your heart more than anything else is conflict in relationship. When your members are upset or upset with one another, when there's an argument, and sometimes even people who decide that that's the time that they must move on from one church to another. And it's troubling for anyone in ministry. And here we have Paul talking about these two in Philippians 4:2. And then going on to have this conversation, this imperative, this command to the people of Philippi. He says, rejoice in the Lord always. And I say it again, rejoice. Anything worth saying that is important is worth repeating. And you notice preachers like myself, we often repeat ourselves sometimes because we don't hear ourselves saying it clearly enough. And maybe that's what Paul felt. Because he didn't hear himself say, rejoice. The Greek word is chairete. It's related to the word charis, the word for grace, the word for the excitement which comes at realizing you have something you did not deserve, a gift. My little boy had a birthday just the other day, and we gave him several gifts, and we bought him a gaming headset for a PlayStation. We bought him a light table because he loves to draw, so it's a light table he can put his drawings on and trace. But the gift he loved the most was a t-shirt with his favorite cartoon character on it, and he wore it proudly through the day, and he was just so happy, so full of joy in a sense. And when Paul reminds us, rejoice, it is that sense of giving thanks for the grace we have, the unmerited favor, or as one theologian put it, the giving thanks for the favor, the grace we have received, which finds its origin in nothing but the pure love and benevolence of God. In other words, it's nothing we've done, nothing we've been able to achieve, which brings about the grace of God in our lives. And as we rejoice in this way, we're rejoicing not over something in the world or something like a party or a birthday or anything like that. We are celebrating simply what God has given us in Christ Jesus. And this is something which Paul then makes the point is impossible unless we have surrendered our lives to Jesus. The fact of this rejoicing, the fact of the grace, means that we rejoice not in ourselves or just, you know, whip ourselves up into a frenzy, but we rejoice in the Lord. This kind of rejoicing is not just a party. It's not just a celebration, or, you know, like we have enjoyed great events in our country and around the world. The moment the Soccer World Cup is going on, and you may be rejoicing over your team, which is winning. But it's not that kind of rejoicing, which is rejoices over a single event. It rejoices over a state of being which is eternal. Jesus says, the one who lives believing in me will never die. And when we rejoice into, the word in Christ is into, and when we rejoice in that word, it is we rejoice in the Lord, it is an eternal thing. We rejoice into something which is not fleeting, or it does not disappear in a moment, but it is there forever, because we rejoice not in a momentary event, but we rejoice in the one who is forever. Rejoice in the Lord. So there's two things about rejoicing in the Lord. The first thing is that we cannot rejoice in this way without first surrendering our lives to Christ. It's pointless thinking we can just be happy because we have a notion of religion, or because we may have gone to church and sung a favorite hymn. The only way we rejoice like this is if we truly surrender our hearts to Christ and give ourselves over to him. Then the kind of rejoicing we can have is a rejoicing in an understanding, in a deep understanding of the eternal Savior. We rejoice in the Lord. The word, as I said, means into. We come into a relationship with Jesus. Paul at one point in Philippians teaches us about being hidden with Christ in God. And this hiddenness means that when God looks at us, he sees not us and our sin and our brokenness and the mistakes we make and the, just the brokenness about our personalities and our lives, which may not be particularly evil or even something we're guilty of, but it's just a brokenness. God doesn't see that. He sees a wholeness, which is the perfection of Christ, the righteousness of Christ. Paul says in another point, righteousness means everything just as it should be in terms of our relationship with us, with others, and with God. So this rejoicing into Christ means we surrender to God, we come into a new relationship with Christ, and because of that relationship with Christ, we are a people who are able to rejoice. Now, after this imperative, this command, I mean, this is Paul, the old minister. He's been in the business of ministry for many, many years. In fact, the end of Philippians, he talks about being poured out like a drink offering. This is near the end of his life. You know, he knows that the ship is sailing. He's going to be going home to Jesus soon. And if there's one thing he just wants to say to the people of the church, don't rejoice in anything but the Lord. You know, our church has had a wonderful year financially. We've just we turned around a really significant deficit amounting to more than 10% of our income. We turned it around and it became a surplus. And so the Lord's been working among us in that area. We've seen people come to Christ in our church. And it's just such a joy when young people give their lives to the Lord. I've watched people grow in Bible studies, and I've seen people just stretch themselves in terms of worship. But whatever we rejoice in about the things that are happening, Paul's imperative is just rejoice in Jesus and what he's given us in terms of his grace. Now, when Paul goes on from this, having given this imperative, rejoice in the Lord, he says, let your gentleness be evident to all. Now, we hear the phrase gentle, Jesus, meek and mild, and it always strikes me as an interesting thing to say, because Jesus was the one who went into the temple with the knotted rope and he drove the money changers out of the temple. So hardly a gentle moment for him. But this kind of gentleness is gentleness which means patience. It means to give others the time to come to faith. We as Christians ought constantly to challenge people not to be lazy about spiritual things, not to simply write things off and think that they're kind of comfortable where they are spiritually, but challenge people to think more deeply about matters of faith. But at the same time, we ought to understand that just because we have a certain understanding of faith, it doesn't mean everyone else is going to, and it ought to be patient with people in terms of their spiritual walk. And this is something that is so important for us to learn as Christians, to give others the time. I had a wonderful conversation with one of our dear faithful ones recently, because I've been plunged into the cross-cultural work in Stellenbosch, working with the English and Afrikaans-speaking congregation in town, and then the Xhosa-speaking congregation in Kaimandi. And it's been such a privilege, but sometimes I feel like I give the impression that I'm forcing others to take that journey and to cross over between the cultures. But it's a hard journey. It's a tough one, especially in South Africa, with language and culture and so many other things. I had a beautiful conversation in which this dear saint and I were able to free each other to be patient with one another, both in terms of their reticence or perhaps just fear of walking the path, and then also my pushiness, and just be a little patient with one another. So I realized I must just tone my activism down a little. But it's okay, you know, we need to be patient with them. Let all know this. The word for evidence is to know, to have an experience. Let others experience your patience deeply in their hearts. So rejoice in what Christ has given you. Give others time to get there. Sure, we challenge them, but we're patient with others, and we're not pushy, but we just give the Lord, we give them and the Lord time to work through these things, allow the Spirit to work within them. And then there's this wonderful promise that comes where Paul the Apostle asserts that we should present our prayers and requests to God. In other words, if we have something on our heart, the word for request is a word which means always to beg, to beseech would be the old English. We ought to beg the Lord for what we feel we need. Jesus at one point says, ask anything in my name and it will be given to you. And what he really means is that as we walk this life of rejoicing and as we allow our lives to be steeped in the gentleness of the Spirit to bring others to faith and to holiness in Christ, that our hearts will become like Christ, our requests will become Christ-like. And when we beg something of God, we'll be begging for the sake and the will of Jesus Christ. And as we do this, we'll find ourselves asking things of which we'll be astounded. My prayer is that the Lord would teach me to understand those who are different from me. And I think the Lord is doing it. I think he is doing it in me, although sometimes we don't realize it's happening. But I beg the Lord, make it easier. Make it a journey that is easier for me and for others. But when we truly come before the Lord and present our prayers and requests, we find through the Spirit our requests becoming requests for the sake of the Lord. And then this key, this, you know, there's a key in almost every text. This key is the word thanksgiving, the word Eucharistein, which is a word used in our Eucharist, in our communion service, but it's the Hebrew word hod or hodu, which is to give thanks to the Lord for his goodness, love endures forever. And this thanksgiving is more than just saying, Lord, hey, thanks for what you've done for me. Thanks for the joy I have in Christ. Thanks for the death of Christ and the forgiveness. Much more than that. This is a lifelong attitude which we develop, an attitude of thanksgiving. It's an attitude which focuses on the covenant eternal love of God, that same love which we experience when we come into Christ, when we surrender into Christ and we come to know him. So this thanksgiving is not just an act of, hey, thank you, Lord, for what you've done for me, but it's an attitude of the heart where we live appreciative of the eternal God. We live knowing that what we have in this world and what we've accomplished is only thanks to the Lord and what he's done in our lives and continues to do. This attitude of thanksgiving we must live for. And then the promise that the peace of God, which passes understanding, would guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Now, the peace of God is not only an absence of trouble or of peace in the sense of the absence of war, but the peace of God is a deep inner knowledge that what is happening now will have an eternal outcome. One friend of mine prayed when we were praying in the COVID situation for the churches, and she prayed, we pray for God's outcome. And it's such a good prayer that we would pray for God's outcome, because it reminds us that the hope we have, the hope we have is not our own hope. It's not a hope that our problems will be resolved here and now, and that will just be great. But it's a prayer that God's outcome would be achieved in our lives. And this peace of Christ, which passes understanding, is a peace which is assured that ultimately God's purposes will be served and his outcome will prevail. And so this is the promise. As we begin to rejoice in Christ, we surrender into him, and our joy comes from what he has given us, this grace he's given us, and that we are patient with others. Even though we may have experienced something or walked a road, that we're just patient with others, as much as Paul may have been frustrated with people like Euodia and Syntyche. And then being patient with others, allowing them to know that patience, just as the Lord has given us patience, we then present our prayers and requests to God, begging for what we know the Lord needs to do in our lives. And then finally, to experience this peace of Christ, which is mind-boggling. It's beyond what we can comprehend, because it takes hold of it arrests us, and it pins us down, and it gives us the strength to walk through the difficult times. And so may you experience this joy, which combined with the patience to allow others to walk the same road you have walked, so that you bring the requests to God which are the deep inner desires of your heart and are inspired by the Lord's Spirit. But then finally may you experience the peace of Christ, which passes understanding, to guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.